Sunday I wanted Stisha to be able to get up before because she goes back home to Costa Rica tomorrow. And it's just been such a blessing to have Stisha here with me. Amen. So she's been helping me out, getting some paperwork and stuff done. And me and Stisha and Hannah just been hanging. Me and Stisha just, you know, so I'm going to miss you, Stisha, when you leave. Even though we Skype every week, you know, because we were like, no, I need to see your face. Amen. All right. Amen. Today, I'm going to be talking about the comforter of my soul. Amen. You know, I was preparing. And I was like, this ain't, I had the title, but I couldn't get nothing from it, you know. And it was so funny because Wednesday night, Elder Grant started hitting on some stuff. I'm like, well, all right, but you know, that I didn't need to talk about that no way. But but what I got out of my personal time with God was the comforter of my soul. I'm like, oh, this is, I know this. I can talk about this. Amen. Well, it ain't going to be no Pastor Steve message because he was the one and only. Amen. Amen. And, you know, even just watching his messages, you know, and so Joby listened to him, and I was watching it the one the other night, and I thank God that I can still see him. I can still hear his voice, you know, so, and it's still a cutting word, you know. Amen. Amen. So this morning I'm going to be talking about the comforter of my soul. Amen. And if some tears come out, just overlook that. You know. Amen. But I knew I had to get up to be able to speak. Amen. Because this Pastor Darby, he trained us on what to do, so I'm going to do it.
Amen.
Amen. This message will help those who are seeking to be filled with the infilling of God's Spirit. Let me read that again. This message will help those who are seeking to be filled with the infilling. Not that you felt something, the infilling, the bubbling up of God's Spirit. Before I knew God, my spirit man was just dead. We went to church, but I didn't know God. I came up in a Baptist church, but I didn't know God. You know, my grandfather was a deacon, and my grandmother was the wife. So the deacon sit on the front row, the wife sit on the second row, and the our row was always filled because my grandmother, if you was in her house, you were going to church, which was good. And she had that black cone, you know, like y'all cut up up in here. You know, I come from the old school, you know, like you would get it, and then she'll look at you, you know, and we thought it was so funny when we saw these people just. It wasn't the Holy Spirit in me, but it was just, you know. And so we'd be on that, and she'd look at us like, keep laughing. And then, you know, but she was the woman that gave all the kids candy, so everybody knew us the candy lady. And then when church was out, life as usual would happen. We get in the car, my grandfather light up his cigarette, cuss words flying. But when we got home, it was always an adult there that had to stay to cook meal. So when we got home from church, it was always a cooked meal. And the food was good. My family could cook, so the food was always good, and it was always enough for everyone, whoever came over to that house. You know, so, but I didn't know God. And I remember, and then as I'm becoming a teenager, she's making me and my sister go to, like, youth service, and I'm like, oh my God, why we gotta go? And it's like, oh, I didn't even like Sunday school as a child. I'm like, I didn't understand God. I'm like, why we gotta, we already go to school Monday through Friday. I didn't even understand Sunday school, you know? And I didn't understand God, not just saw this form and fashion, but I didn't see God live. I didn't see God exercise in everyday life. And until my husband's mother got saved, and that's when I began to see God, because I saw her before her transition to God, and then when she became a Christian, she began to change, you know, and then she started talking to me about God's love. I was out of skirt, you know, like, what do you mean God's love, you know, And then she was telling, you know, like, y'all fornicating is wrong. And I'm like, what? You know. But then one night I was at his house and I heard her speaking in tongues. And I was like, Steve, your mama's in there crying. He said, no, she ain't. And I heard this, her crying again in this noise. I was like, Steve, your mama's in there crying. He said, no, she's in there praying. And then that's the first time I saw God. And I was like, okay, well, this woman I used to know that did these things, she don't do it no more. So that was the first time I saw a real Christian in my life. And I was going to church all my life. And I knew that she wasn't crazy when these words started coming out of her mouth, blah, 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 because I knew, I'm like, wait a minute. This woman ain't doing the things she used to do. And I didn't even know the Bible. And I was like, wait a minute, something, because you know, you've heard them people that talk in tongues, they crazy. You know, there's something wrong with them. But I'm like, she ain't crazy. So that's how I began to know what a real Christian was. Let me get back to my message. I didn't even know that I had a spirit. I was living out of my flesh, doing anything and everything I thought was right to me. Here I am, a 20-year-old woman with two children. I had just had little Steve when God started touching, dealing with me in my life. I was pregnant with little Steve, and I thought, shoot, I got a little boy, I got a little girl, a couple more years, I'ma legally change my name. Like, if we ain't gonna get, cause if it was the time, he was ready to marry me at 16, but my silliness, black woman silliness, it's like, it don't take all that, you don't need God for all that, and then you do. And so, you know, but I didn't know that. Listen to my family, foolishness. I'm wise now, so we'll still be talking about Jezebel. We'll still be talking about all this stuff. Amen. So here I am, a 20-year-old woman with two children, dealing with a crushed heart due to sin. Like I said, the first time he was ready to marry me, he had just got saved, and I'm talking, you don't take all that, you don't need God, just go marry me. But we don't, because I wasn't ready to serve God like that. Because I had it in my heart that, shoot, when I turn 21, I'm about to go back out with the girls, you know. Because that was what was in my heart. So I didn't want to commit to no God. I wanted to try to do what I wanted to do again. But God, he crushed me a year before my 21st birthday. Amen. And he did a crushing. And I thought I could manipulate God to stay in fornication in a spiritually dead life. I wasn't even thinking about God at all, and I wasn't. As long as I had Cisha, Steve, and this new baby, I was straight. I just try not to. I live across the street from a church, so I just try not to cuss, you know, because the church, I was convicted because after I seen his mother change, I knew God was real. So I'm like, I ain't going to be cussing by no church. I won't go to hell. You know, I ain't gonna go hell, but I didn't want to change either. You know, and I was kind of messed up because now I knew. And then she gave me this Bible to start reading. Because I'm like, I don't understand the Bible when you read it. The King James Version, you don't understand. She was like, Missy, I got a Bible for you to read. Just try to read this one. And it was the NIV. I'm not with the NIV now because we're back to King James because I'm meat fed, so I don't need the word broken down like that no more. But she gave me that Bible, and I began to read it, and I began to understand it. I didn't understand the point. I'm like, what you mean, pluck out your eye? You know, I was taking these things literally. But God's word began to form in me a little bit because I now knew that if I was to die, I was going to hell. I didn't know that, but I still was not ready to serve God with my all. I just wanted my personal life okay, you know, but I didn't want him. Okay, I wasn't even thinking about God at all. God was dealing with this man I was with, and so begun my humbling. Amen? Read. Okay, I forgot to put the chapter in her, I mean the book in her, but I believe it's Proverbs. Let me turn to it. Let me turn to it first before I tell you. It's not Proverbs, it's Psalms. So turn to Psalms 21, 44. Psalms 21 and 44. When you get there, say amen. It ain't it either. What is talking about? Fall on the rock. Actually, it's not. It's in the New Testament. Fall on the rock and receive grace. The rock will fall on you and crush you. Well, because I was so stubborn, the rock had to fall on me and crush me. So that's why I'm talking about this. I was crushed. God had to actually crush me because I was not letting go. I was wanting what I was wanting, and he had to humble me. Amen. I found myself in need of this God's love. After I was humbled, after he had to crush me and humble me, I then found myself in need of this God's love, mercy, and forgiveness. God finally had my undivided attention. How many times God has to do it in our lives? Because we refuse to listen to him. God, I want this man. You gonna make this happen. God ain't doing that. That's your will. That's called witchcraft. Here I am operating in witchcraft and thinking that God is with me because my childhood was messed up. No, that's not how it works. God is not going to go against his word just because you had a bad childhood or because you want something that you, it ain't God's will for you. Amen. Okay, let me see where I was. Okay. And he had my undivided attention, and he did. He really, truly did. Because it's like all the whole Louisville saw, and I didn't care. I couldn't care less what they saw. I was wanting what I was wanting. And God sort of deal with me. At first, I didn't even like prayer. I felt it was so time-consuming. I did. His mother would take me to these prayer meetings and, you know, to pray. Because they see, this girl needs Jesus. But I'm like, I wanted them to see, no, I need this man. You know? And so they praying for me, you know. And, you know, but I was like, oh, Lord, we got to go to these prayer meetings. I just want somebody to hear from the Lord and tell me, thus said the Lord, this is your husband. I was in my manipulation. You know, but God is still banging me. Praying it out. And at the time I was praying it out. He's still dealing with me. So I would go to the prayer meetings and I really wasn't getting nothing out of it. But I kept going to church with his mother. I did. I didn't understand it, and I would sit there and it seemed like the longest services ever because I wasn't used to church. Amen. Holy Spirit filled church, let me put it like that. Spirit filled church is a different church than everybody else church, because you in there, you gonna learn, you gonna, back then, let me clarify that too. Back then, there was meat in every church, in every spirit filled church. My church, they came from the old holiness church, but they was getting out of that cotton stockings. Lord, I mean, if y'all would see cotton stockings, it's like, oh my goodness. You know, like I saw some cotton stockings up close. I was like, oh my goodness. No, you know, and where the women couldn't comb their hair, you know, looking all rough and hard, you know, but the men are looking good. You know, they looking flying in the women, you know. But the church I was at, they was getting out of that into, okay, if a woman put on some pants, she ain't gonna sin, you know. Don't be showing your body, you know. If she put on some makeup, she ain't gonna sin. But this stuff now is just too far. It's like, Pastor Steve had to show me those videos. I didn't even know, and I'm a woman. I didn't even know about these makeup videos. These women be doing this contouring and all this stuff. And I saw, he was like, Missy, look at this. And I'm like, what? You know, a lot of stuff he taught me. So I'm sitting here learning just like y'all. That's why my face be shocked, like, what? You know, like when he was talking about the drug references that day, and he said that red hair. And so when we was at home, I said, oh, sweetie, they putting red hair in alcohol. You know, like the worm in alcohol, whatever that's called. He was like, no, Missy. He said that's just a different potency for the THC and weed. I was like, oh, I didn't know. I thought it was a drink. I didn't know, you know. So he be schooling me. He was like, Missy, you got to know all this stuff because this is what they into. This is how people live. They come to church, but this is what they life is. And I was like, oh, I didn't know. I learned about the black. I didn't know about no freaking no black. But I caught on to probably what it was because I didn't know about a black and mild until Sheena, I have to put your name in, since she joined our show. And when I saw her smoking a black and mild, I'm like, oh my God, this woman is smoking a cigar. I didn't know because I had been saved for some years. And I was living in the world, but I was not of the world. So it was the first time I saw a woman smoking a cigar. And I was like, oh my God, this girl is smoking a cigar. And I had never saw that. And I, you know, and so I didn't, you know, I just didn't know. Well, okay, let me get back to where I was. Amen. Okay, but anyways, I said I didn't like prayer. I wanted God to give me what I wanted now. But we know God is perfectly patient. He's a patient God. Time is in his hands. Amen. And that's what I needed for him. He dealt with me, and he was wisely dealing with me. He didn't care about this pain I was feeling. I needed this. I can actually say I needed this breaking in my life. I needed this because this is what drew me to him. Amen. I'm thankful that I belong to a Holy Spirit-filled church that prayed. We would still have our prayer meetings at church, and I would still go, you know, because I did. Once he broke me and I had to deal with that, I kept going. I didn't understand it, but I kept going because I'm like, okay, God, I know I need you. I know, and I began to know he's dealing with me because doors in my life kept shutting. I mean, it was just... If I was blind, if you were blind, you could see that God was dealing with me at this point in time in my life. I didn't need another man. It was God, and I knew that he was dealing with me. And, you know, I done had my baby, and I'm trying to go back to work, and the door shut where I can't even get childcare. So I'm sitting in my house, and I'm like, oh, I don't want to be here. I just want to go to work to get my mind off of God. I'm still trying to run. And he's still saying, Missy, no, I want you. I'm still gonna deal with you. And so I was like, okay, God. Okay, you know, and I just kept going to church. And like I said, I know it wasn't another man that I needed to bring in my home. I had already told myself, ain't no other man coming up in here, you know, and I was serious about that. So I'm like, well, okay, well, Jesus, you gonna have to be this man to me that I need, you know. And he was. I'll get there, but he was. Amen. Like I said, I'm thankful that I belong to a Holy Spirit-filled church that prayed. In my house, I got on my knees in my bedroom the very day that I knew I had to totally release this man. I got on my knees in my bedroom, and be mindful, I'm still living in the projects. Over here in Shepherd Square, amen, I'm still living in those projects, and you know it wasn't corporate. So I put a little rug, I had a little rug on the floor. And I got on my knees, and I cried out to God. And I said, God, if you heal me, I'll serve you for the rest of my life. And I meant that. I meant that, and I still mean that. Amen? Okay, and I began to pray. My first heartfelt prayer, asking God to heal my heart. And if he did, I would serve him for the rest of my life. Our church had an evangelist hold meetings, and he was at our prayer meeting. He's actually the man my husband got saved under at the time. My husband was at a different church, but when he first gave his life to God, he was the man that got him saved that day and got him filled that day at this church. And in my arrogance then, it was actually on Halloween night. I'll never forget it because I was over Steven's sister's house, and we were going to take our children. It was just Stisha and John. We was going to take them trick-or-treating, and him and his mother was at church, and I'm like, where are they at? Come on, I'm ready to go trick-or-treating. And he's getting spirit-filled at the church, but I'm like, come on, I want to go trick-or-treating. Let's, you know, it's getting dark, you know. And I was clueless as to what had happened in his life. Because I didn't know God like that. I didn't, you know. Okay, he asked for those, this evangelist, he asked those who had not received the infilling of the Holy Spirit to raise their hands. And so we did. And so he said, whatever you do for 30 days becomes a habit. And if you begin to spend time with God, giving him 1 hour of your time before you start your day.
Amen.
Don't give him leftovers. He don't want it. I'll keep telling him that. He don't want to keep it. Amen. He wants the before. Amen. And he said if you give him 1 hour of your day before you start your day, you would begin to grow spiritually. I took his advice and began to spend time with God. He had told us to partner up, get prayer partners. And of course, you know, female to female, it's never going to be female and male. No, 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 no. So female to female, me and his sister, you know, we got up on the phone every morning. Our prayer time was 6 a.m. or whatever. But anyways, I began to spend time with God on my own, too. And I just, every day, he told me, get a little notepad. And this is what I tell people today who's looking to be spirit-filled. And raise your hands if you come to this ministry and did what we told you to do to be spirit-filled, and you got spirit-filled. Thank you. Amen. The Holy Spirit is still moving today. You can still be infilled. It ain't no Old Testament, no New Testament thing back thousands of years ago. No, this is still happening because you're going to need this Holy Spirit to live in this natural life. Amen. Okay. And like I said, I began to pray to God, and I had my little notepad, and I would read a chapter a day out of the Bible, and I'll pray, and I'll just, be mindful I had 2 children, I would get up in the wee hours of the morning while my children were still asleep before I started third day and spend time with God. And I'll write in my little notepad, your notebook, what I got out of my time with God. And every day I would date it. It wasn't for nobody to me to go front and be like, ooh, look at me, I'm deep. No, it was for my personal time with God. It wasn't for nobody to read, to get their point off. And I did date that the day that I had got on my knees in my bedroom. But my Bible, you know, if you're a Christian, if you're a real Christian, you're going to go through some Bibles in your life. So the date that I had put in there, it had tore out of my Bible, and I was like, dang, I would have loved. But I remember it was around the fall time. It was beginning to get cold outside. So I remember that was my real conversion, my Paul moment with God, where I really got converted in my heart. But anyways, I kept doing this, and I still wasn't spirit-filled yet. But I kept praying, and I kept seeking God, and God began, for the first time ever, God began to deal with me with some issues in my heart. I was talking to Stephen's mother one day, and she was like, well, Missy, well, you know you got to forgive your mama. I'm like, what? So, no, God understands. He know what she did. And she was like, no, baby, you know, God's look, you got. And after she said that, don't you know God started dealing with me? She's like, and so I was like, okay. And I knew it was God dealing with me. And so I had to do that. And it wasn't no one day doing this. This was a continual thing of dealing with my heart over this situation. Because our goal when me and my sister was growing up, our goal was to get on the Oprah show and tell Oprah all about it. You know, because we watched the Oprah every day as teenagers. And we were like, man, we're going to get on the Oprah show. We're going to tell her what happened, you know, but we didn't know, you know. And so, and you know, as I'm going through that journey of forgiving, that's why even when Pastor Darby be preaching, he'll say, it don't matter if you have issues with the baby daddy. It ain't the baby daddy. You still need to forgive. The cheating husband. It don't matter. You still need to forgive, because in all that, God is a restorer. He can restore that messed up marriage. He can restore that messed up relationship with that baby daddy, because that child It's not about your pain. It's that child still going to need that baby daddy in his life. Amen. And I'm a witness. And when you turn right, you can get that baby daddy back. Amen. And I love you. Amen. Amen. Okay. And so I began to grow. And I began to long for my personal time with God. You know, when I be at work, I be thinking about God. I'm like, ooh, you know, you standing there, you just be worshiping God in your mind. You just, God is good, you know. And you do go to the bathroom, so sometimes you're like, ooh, God, thank you, Jesus, you are worthy. And when you have that countenance in you, people see it. People be like, things change. I like being around you. You know, and I agree, how are you doing? I agree to everybody, you know, and I learned that, okay, you need to watch what you watch on TV. So I did. I stopped watching things I shouldn't watch on TV. You know, and I just sort of making sure that I was watching good programming if I did watch TV. And, you know, and then when I learned that speaking negative words, our tongue is the power of life and death. And if you can speak life or death, determining on what you say, I stopped speaking negative words. And definitely over my children, I wouldn't even say you bad. No, you did something wrong. I would explain to what they did. I never called my children stupid ever in their life. I was talking to somebody the other day, and they said that they cussed at their child. I said, you did what? And they was like, yeah, you know, when they get me there, I'll cuss them out. I'll say, no, don't ever. That's, you know, those words are over your child. They was like, you know, the person's like, well, they know I love them and I'll do anything for them. I said, yeah, I said, they know you love them. I said, but those words are going to be more. That's going in the spirit, man. And I said, just like, I was giving them the example. I said, just say, for instance, a woman that's with a man, he say he love her, but he beating her all the time. Right. I said, what do you think she's going to believe more? Right. Right. He's like, no, you know, like right. She's going to equate the love with being beat. Right. 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 And so that's what a lot of us in the black community are dealing with now, equating negative words with the chaos with normalcy, right. You know. And when you come into something normal, in a normal atmosphere, you feel like, oh, these people are trying to control me. We just normal. We don't want to know your business. We ain't with your chaos. We ain't with your arguing and fighting. And you think it's control. No, it's because you've been in chaos all your life. You know. And so I was like, and I said, you know, and it was something that Joe had did years ago, and we were just talking about it. I said, that was the only, I said, I used the word stupid. I said, I didn't call him stupid. I said, the situation. And she was like, are you serious? That's the only time you said something like that to him? I said, yeah. Amen. I'm like, we're not speaking death over our children. We're not, you know, foolishness is in the heart of every child. You know, but I ain't gonna be like, come here, fool. No, that ain't your name. Oh, the situation, I gotta tell y'all this. Lord, shut up. Anyways, me and Steve went to the store yesterday to get the stuff for tonight. So, I mean, I thought that it was four lines open. This was a different kind of store. Four lines open. And you see these people just lined up. I thought they was going into lane two. So Steve had this big old, you have these big old long court things. So I was like, come on, Steve. So I'm telling the little Chinese man, excuse me. So he's trying to move out the way. This man behind him, a white man, we ain't got a problem with white people, come on. But this man gonna have it in his heart to tell me to, you need to wait. You need to go to the back of the line and wait a couple of minutes. And I said, I'm going past. I'm saying excuse me to this man so I can go get in this farthest lane. And this man want to open up and try to rebuke me forever. He's in error. And he was like, well, this place is just chaos. And so this is how they run it. I was just trying to help you out. He thought by him opening his mouth to tell me something to go to the back of the line and wait like them, that he's helping me out. I said, I don't need your help. I'll go to the worker. The worker's right there. And I said, ma'am, isn't every lane, every register has its own lane? She said, yes. I said, thank you. I said, Steve, come on, move his court over to this lane. Yeah. And so You know, and so the Chinese man went to the lane I was going to go to. I said, well, okay, you can have that lane, but it's a lane right here, too. So I went to that lane. So here this man that's saying this stuff go come up. Well, I've been standing in line. There's four lanes. So once I got into the right lane, everybody else got into the right lane, and there was no issues. But this man still wanted to have it in his heart that he's right because he said it. I said, no, you're wrong. You're wrong, and he couldn't accept that he was wrong. And he's going to look at me and be like, seriously, you want to do this? I said, no, you're wrong. I'm not wrong. And he was like, well, I'll get right here, too. I said, yeah, you're going to go after me. You know? But the urgency of this man, thinking that because he spoke, I'm supposed to obey him. Like, I said, who are you? Who are you? Who gave you the authority to tell? He don't even work there. So Worker confirmed that he was wrong. And the man was still mad because I wouldn't let him tell me what to do. I don't even know you. And then he gonna say, girl. I said, girl? I said, I am a woman. I am an adult. He said, well, ma'am, miss. I said, well, thank you. You know. But the urgency of him, like, you don't know me. He's wrong because they in the line wrong. I ain't even mad at them. They in some kind of different line. I'm just trying to go around. And he wouldn't move his court. So little Steve was like, dude, that's my mama. And, you know, but I don't know if because I wasn't. I just threw on some pants and, you know, shoes or whatever. And Stisha, when I got home, I was telling Stisha, he said, mama, he probably thought you was a child, you know, until you start talking. But then something like, and I kept telling him, you're wrong. Even though was clearly seen that he was wrong, he was still wanting to be right. Like, I'm going to tell you. Like, no, you can't tell me anything. You know, who are you? What gives you the right to tell me something? Well, he's wrong. He was absolutely wrong, you know. I jumped off, and that's what I tell your father. I was like, sweetie, I can't. I'll jump off. I said, how do you stay on point? You'll still get back on point. And I'll be right there sitting there still trying to be on, you know, what was the last scripture he read? And I still get off. So I'll be like, sweetie, how do you still remember? You'll be talking for a while, and then you'll still remember what scripture you was on. I'm like, I can't do that. I'll be talking to him and forget what I'm talking about. I can't do that. Okay, but I'm trying to remember the point I was making. Oh, chaos, right. And so she was shocked that that was the only word that I had used for my children. And I was like, I said, you speak life. You watch what you say over your child. You don't cuss them out. You know, your words are powerful. Watch how you speak to your children and how you speak to people, period. Honor is everything. If you're dishonorable, you're going to be dishonored. If you're honorable, you're going to be honored, and doors will always open for you. But if you're a person who's always going through something, and you don't understand why people don't like you, maybe you're dishonorable. And that's a different message, and we'll talk about that later. Amen? Okay. But anyways, as I begin to grow with God, I begin to just love my worship time with God and be mindful. I'm still single. Yes, celibate. We believe in this. If a real Christian, you live a celibate lifestyle. Amen? And I'm growing in God. You know, I'm just loving this God. I'm just loving his love for me. Like, you love me, God. You love me when I didn't even love you. When I was telling you that I don't want you like that, you still love me. And so when I saw his love for me, I was like, God, how could I do you like this? I was just so broken in my heart. Like, how can I do you like this? You know, but he was still loving me back. You know, and then I'm dealing with the issues in my life, and I had to love those who I had to forgive. You can't go to heaven and you ain't forgiven. And so I had to go forgive people. Amen? Okay. I was told to just talk to God. Oh, and because I didn't know how to pray, the evangelist had said, just talk to God as if he's somebody next to you, because Even when I talk to people, a lot of people don't know how to pray. And they're like, well, how do you pray? You know, it just feels so weird, you know, because they don't know how do you talk to God, you know? I said, well, just talk to him as if he's right there with you, because he is. Even in your sin, he's still right. He's looking, you know, he's just talk to him as if he's right there with you. You know, like you're talking to a person on the phone. Just talk to him and be like, well, God, I don't know how to talk to you, but, you know, this is what I'm dealing with.
Amen.
Well, that's beginning of prayer. That's you being real. Amen?
Amen?
And so I began to do that, and I found that my words for him began to grow. My attributes of him begin to grow. As I'm beginning to pray, like I said, I started out, I didn't know how to pray, but as I begin to continue to pray, I'll be in my natural, because I still wasn't spirit filled yet. I begin to pray him in the natural. Father, you're worthy. I adore you. You're awesome. I worship you this morning. I love you. You keep saying that. Shoo. You talk to a man like that, so my husband taught me. Man, you talk to a man like that, shoo, he ain't gonna leave you. My husband was so wise. He taught me. And I ain't ashamed to say he taught me. He's like, Missy, this is how I like it. I want to be treated. Okay, I'm going to learn, you know. And that's what we do at Destiny Ministries. We teach you about your marriage. You're going to learn how to do this right. That's your job. It ain't our job to make you do it, you know. And he taught me well. He taught our children well. And that's why we're up here doing what he said to do. Amen. But anyways, like I said, my words for the Father begin to grow. I begin to experience this love relationship with him. And he began to be my God. And Jesus began to become my Lord and Savior. And I wasn't ashamed. I think I might have had a birthday. I'm 21 years old. And I ain't ashamed to tell you that Jesus loves you. That, hey, you know Jesus? And I will stop everybody. If they speak to me, even me, and they'll be like, hey, girl, hey, I got somebody for you. His name is Jesus. And every time they'll be like, man, thank you for that. That's good. And because I'm like, okay, God, if you give me the opportunity to say something, show me what to say, and I would do that. And not once did a man cuss me out for doing that. Amen. Not once. I was stopping at the store one day, and I was walking back to the church, and these guys was on the porch, and they were smoking weed. Like, okay, God, what do you want me to say? Because they like, hey, girl, hey. And I was like, hey, y'all know Jesus. You know, y'all, yeah. I'm like, I'll pray for y'all or whatever. People won't turn down prayer. And so little did I know, I ended up becoming a corrections officer, and I was working at the jail. And so I was going past the dorm one day, and the guy came up to the window, hey, hey. And I'm like, you know what? Because it was a young, aggressive dorm, they used to all house them together, the young ones, and then they stopped because they were just too young and aggressive, and they always doing stuff. So you take the young ones and put them in the dorms with older men, and then the older men would knock out the aggression in the young ones. They would physically have to put their hands on the younger boys to show them you ain't tough. And then they'll sit down somewhere and go to sleep. This is jail, y'all. This is how it is. And so the guy was, you know, hey, I know you. I was like, nah. I'm like, nah, you don't know me. You know, because that's what they do when they see a female officer. He was like, yes, I do, because you was that woman that stopped us that day when we were smoking weed on that porch and said, you're a prank. Y'all, she's a Christian. I said, yeah. I said, that's me. I said, when you get out, you gonna come to my church? You know, oh, he never came, but when you're a real Christian, you'll have that impact on somebody's life. It ain't just these four walls and no more. So that's why Pastor Darby was even big on the outreach, going out to the streets, reaching those in your area of influence wherever you are, Amen. On your job, and being wise. I'll get to that point about being wise as a Christian. I mean, because some people, I'll get to that point, you just turn people off. It's just, okay. And as I continue to pray and pray and pray, go through my walk with God, I was at home in my front room. Now, my front room was carpeted because I had to go buy some carpet from my front room. And I was praying, and I think my children, I think they might have been with their father that night. And if you know the Project Doors, you had to go up the steps to enter my house. So my husband had this long bar where he was living there that we had put by the door. That way you couldn't run in. So I kept using it because I'm single. I don't want I've heard stories where people broke in your house and you sleep. So I kept using that bar. So I was in the front room praying, and I thought I fell asleep, but I heard this talking, and I jumped up, and I said, "Who's there?" And I was like, "Wait a minute, ain't nobody here." And I saw the bar was still at the door, and so I got back down, and I was praying, and I heard it again. And I said, "Wait a minute, Missy, maybe this is the Holy Spirit." And I got to talking, and it just started bubbling up out of me. And I was like, it was the Holy Spirit. I'm thinking somebody's in here. And so I got the phone, and I called his mother, and she heard me talking. She knew it was me, and she's like, "Woo, hallelujah." And you know his mother. The natural, and I couldn't, and I was trying to tell Miss Dorby I got first, but I was and I couldn't stop. And she's like, "Oh, thank you." She got the praising God, so we were both on the phone praising God. And then I got off the phone with her, and I called my best friend, and she knew it was me, and she was like, "Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus." And for God to love somebody like me, a little insignificant, little Missy, He started working in my life. And I was like, "God, I love you," And I began to grow. And people around me thought that, "Girl, you're going too far." Right. I had my grandfather tell me that. And I was, because I read in the scripture, old her is wisdom. You get around old her, you're going to get some wisdom. So I said, "Shoot, I'm about to get around my grandparents." Because both sets of my grandparents were still living at the time. One set still is, and my grandmother just passed a couple of years ago. And so I'm getting around them, thinking I'm about to give me some wisdom. They ain't have it. But I didn't know that. My grandfather was like, I didn't know that my life was beginning to convict them. It was around Christmas time. So I'm getting around them, and I'm over there, and my grandfather looked at me and said, "Girl, you're going to go crazy serving God like that." And I said, "Okay, I know this is not God, and I know this is not what God's word said," because I had developed a relationship with God. I didn't know, but they drank, and I didn't know I was convicting them. Amen. Like I said, he's deacon, and then my auntie's boyfriend wanted to say something about the church that she go to. You got to pay tithes, and I'm like, okay, this will be my last, this will be my last time coming around any festive holidays. I won't do this no more. Because my grandfather was like, "I saw a broad try to serve God like at once, and she went crazy. That girl went crazy." And I was like, "Wait a minute, I know the Holy Spirit don't make you crazy." So I knew that that's when I found out that, oh, he didn't know. They didn't know. They didn't know. And so I got around my other grandmama, and she didn't know. And I was like, "What?" So the gray hair is only for those who have the wisdom, spiritually have wisdom. Because naturally, you have natural wisdom, but they didn't have the spiritual wisdom. So I was like, okay, I don't get it from them. So I started getting around my church family, And I started real setting my order in my life of who I'm around. And then everybody else my age that I used to be around, they was like, "Missy, you going too far. You just taking this too far. You too young to be doing all this." They trying to convince me I just need a man, that I just need to go back out, and God don't want you to just do all because you too young. God don't want you to try to serve him like that. They didn't know his word. And so I said, okay, this will be my last time running with them also. Because they didn't have the wisdom that I I wasn't looking for wisdom from them because I know they didn't know, but they was bent on seeing me still sinning and say that God understands that. No, God don't understand sin. He's never going to acknowledge your sin. Amen? Okay. Okay, and I began to read for a long time with the Father. Okay. Oh, let me go 1 Corinthians 6 and 19. 1 Corinthians 6. I ain't even got into the word fully yet. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost which is in you? Which ye have of God, and ye are not your own. They didn't know that their temple is not their own. I begin to understand my temple ain't my own. I live for him. Amen. That's why you're going to have to give an account for what you do in this body. Everything you do with this body. Your body ain't for weed. It ain't for cigarettes. It ain't for alcohol. It ain't for fornication. It ain't for none of that. Amen. Amen. And then I want to go to John chapter 14. When you get there, say amen. 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 And I'm going to read verses 1 through 14. Let not your hearts be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house I with many what? If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whether I go, ye know, and the way ye know. And Thomas, well, of course, he said what he said. I'm just reading what Jesus said. And Jesus said unto him, let's read that together. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Amen?
Amen.
So that just knocks out what people are trying to spew now. We ain't moving off. Yes, we know our identity. That's who we are. And we know that we are still Christ's followers. Amen. It ain't hurting me, no. We know this. Amen. Jesus was a Hebrew, tribe of Judah. Hallelujah. So are we receiving? Amen. Burnt bronze skin. You don't know what you mean? Amen. And actually, because there are white people that follow Pastor Steve, there's people from all over the world. There's hardcore Muslims that follow Pastor Dorothy. There's hardcore Hebrew Israelites that follow Pastor Dorothy. Because they was like, man, this man still speaking the truth. You can't find this nowhere. There's people all over in every land following Pastor Steve. And we had an email from a woman, and she was just saying she's a white woman, and that she follows Pastor Steve, and she now knows that we are the people of the book, and that Jesus was black. And, but she was just saying the issue that she homeschooled her children and teach them the Bible, but the issue that she's dealing with is when she shuts her eyes, seeing a black Jesus, even though she now knows that Jesus is black, it's undeniable that Jesus is black. And that we are the people. With all this stuff we going through in this land and in the scattered lands where we are, it's undeniable, you know. And so that wasn't the issue she was dealing with. It was just seeing this black Jesus because everything has been painted white, you know. And so, and that's what she was just saying. She was like, I know. She said, but when I shut my eyes. And so just think what the psychological programming we had to deal with. We shut our eyes and we always saw white Jesus. We had no issues. We had no issues at all. Amen. But and some of us now, even when we shut our eyes and we black, having to say, what? Jesus is really black? What? And then on top of it, what? I'm a Hebrew. I'm like Jesus. Like what? we had those messages in order. Who are we? What do we do? You know, he had them, so you go and look at them. Amen. And that's helping so many people. All his messages are helping a lot of people. Amen. So let me get back to where I was. If you know me, you should have known my Father also. And from henceforth, ye know him and have seen him. And Philip said unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it suffices us. Jesus said unto him, have I been so long time with you, and yet thou hast not known me? Philip, he that hath seen me hath seen the Father. And how sayest thou then, show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? We believe that, Jesus. The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. Amen. And that's what we believe. That's what we believe. The Father doeth the works through us. Amen. Believe me that I am in the Father, and that the Father in me, or else believe me for thy works' sake. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto the Father. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do. So why do we use the name of Jesus? He said, whatsoever you ask in his name, that he shall do. So we still gonna use that name that's above every name. We still believe that demons tremble at that name. It don't matter, amen. We believe that, amen. So we use that name, whether you say Yeshua, our Jesus, it's just another translation. We still calling on the same things. The demons know who, you know, the who you tremble, who's trembling. When you say Jesus' name, they trembling. Amen. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do. And the Father may be glorified, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. And if ye ask anything in my name, I will do it. So, amen. So, when I was single, when I realized that, trying to find that point. Okay, God's word said it, so I believed it and begun to use the authority in the name of Jesus. So I wouldn't, if I had a headache when I was a new Christian, I was like, well, I ain't supposed to, I gotta use this authority in the name. I believed it. I was silly when I was unsaved, and I did silly things, so why am I gonna change my faith in silliness to believe, you know, now that I'm saved? So I'm like, well, if God's word said it, I'm going to believe it. So I got a headache one day, and I rebuked that headache in the name of Jesus, and it left. So I'm like, okay, and I still don't allow headaches. I don't allow the common cold in the name of Jesus. I'm a bleach woman, but even a common cold, I don't want you, you know, and I will rebuke it in the name of Jesus. I don't want it. And if a virus got to go through, my system has got to go through, but I don't want you. I still ain't going to claim you in the name of Jesus. Amen. And then we're going to read John. So we're going to stay in John 15 through 18. Verses 15 through 18. If you love me, keep my commandments. If you love me, keep my commandments. And we still get letters and little comments. Keep the commandments. Man, do you know what the commandment Jesus is talking about? I mean, they don't, because they don't use the New Testament, only if they're trying to use Paul to try to rebuke you. And it's like, no, it don't work like that. Either use all of it or leave it all alone. You can't pick and choose what you want. And then how you going to deal with a spirit-filled Christian on top? Please stop. We are getting a instant download from the Father, his spirit in us, to cause our eyes to see. You still got blind on your eyes. That's why you still standing in a disagreement against him. But our blindness, it's the spiritual blindness we're talking about. Amen? Amen. So let me read this. If you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he should give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. So Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father that he should give you another comforter. Amen? That he may abide, live in you forever, not over her. I mean, how the Holy Ghost, he ain't no thing. Amen. a good book out there to read for those of you all who don't know the personhood of the Holy Spirit. He's a gentleman. Good Morning, Holy Spirit by Benny Hinn. It's an older book, but it's good. But it's a good book. Amen. Even the Spirit of Truth. So this Holy Spirit, this new comforter, is the Spirit of Truth. He's going to comfort me. He's going to abide with me forever. Even the Spirit of Truth, whom the world cannot receive. So why would you listen to somebody who don't know God? They cannot receive. They know truth in them. They might know the truth about the walking against the green light.
Yeah.
Don't do it. You're going to get hit.
Right.
You know. But no spiritual truth. Ain't no spiritual truth there. Right. Amen. Let me find where I'm at. Neither north him. Okay. Even the Spirit of Truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth in you, and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. When I was reading these words in my time with God, I was like, oh, God. I'm like, wow. Like, I just kept feeling comforted even more. He's not going to leave us comfortless. I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more. Yet ye see me, because I live, ye shall live also.
Amen.
Okay, I was supposed to stop it. Okay, at 18. What? No, I'm sorry. When I read this about the Comforter, I knew that I needed this Holy Spirit. Now we're going to pick up reading, starting at verses 19 through 31. Okay, I'll pick up where, what did I stop at?
19.
Yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more, but ye shall see me, because I live, ye shall also live also. At that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him.
Amen.
And Judas said unto the other Judas, he was saying, Lord, is it that thou wilt manifest thyself unto us and not unto the Father? How is it that thou wilt manifest thyself unto us and not to the world? Jesus answered and said unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my words. If a man will love me, he will keep my words.
Amen.
Are you keeping the words of Jesus?
Amen.
Whose words are you keeping? Are you keeping a doctrine, a church doctrine words?
Amen.
Then you're not going to grow off no doctrine, off of a man-made doctrine.
Amen.
This is what you're going to grow off of.
Amen.
In that time alone with your Father.
Yes.
This and this goes hand to hand. If you ain't doing that, we know you ain't growing.
Amen.
You're doing something wrong. Amen?
Amen.
And spending time, what you have to do is spend time with the Father.
Yes.
And get in his word.
Amen.
Cut the TV off, because we're living in such a social media climate. Even I don't know about Facebook. I'll get on there, see some of my children's pictures, but I don't really know about Facebook. And then they've been talking about some more stuff, the Snapchat and, you know, all kind of different little site things. You know, I can care less about social media. That's because that's not how I came up. That's not how I received. I would see these people as, I don't know you. We would talk, don't talk to strangers. I don't know you. I don't receive from you. You can't speak nothing. I ain't gonna even go there with that. But people wanna come and speak into you. Like, I don't know you. We're welfare. I'm gonna say this real quick. I just happened to answer the church phone one day, and so a woman, I said, hello, Destin Ministry, and this woman said, hello, highly blessed and well fed. She said, y'all at Destin Ministries, y'all well fed. You know, and I said, thank you. I said, that's true, we are. You know, she's like, y'all fat on that word. I said, we are, you know. And she said, well, we're starving. She's like, I just found Pastor Dorothy involved. I'm eating on this word, you know. And but that's how people are out there. And so I understand some of you in the internet audience, why you're still connecting and you're still saying, but even though Pastor Dorothy was still going getting in the ministry and connecting, and some of you all did go to a ministry and connect because you need the fellowship, but they'll still say, but Pastor Dorothy's my pastor. And they'll still watch the sermons on YouTube on Wednesday night service live. They'll still watch it. So I understand that, and he understood that, but we still believe that you needed to the local fellowship of the body of believers. And I remember when he first started live streaming, we didn't know the signal wasn't strong enough. So we had people was like, I'm watching, it kept clicking off. And so we're like, well, okay, we're sending it out on our end. Maybe it's something wrong with your end. And so this woman, she was highly upset. She called, she was like, when that happened, she said, I called the cable company the next day. It was like, faster internet speed. She said, so I got that. She said, then the next week, it clicked off. She's like, is it something on y'all end? I was like, no. You know, I'm like, no, we sending it out. But it was something, I forgot what was wrong with it. And it was on our end. And that was Keisha Pittman in California. She's the reason why Pastor Dorby went to California. Because she's been following Pastor Steve for years and years and years. So I just want to give you a shout out, Keisha. She was like, I started getting smart with the cable person. Like y'all doing something. Because I can't be missing these messages because we were live streaming. You know, and so that's when we figured out that maybe something is wrong. It was something wrong with ours. I forget. What was it, Brother Tim? Bandwidth. Okay. And so Pastor Steve was like, well, let's look into call somebody else, get stronger service. And that's what we did. So we shouldn't cut out anymore. Amen. But people, because we were taking it for granted, because see, Pastor Steve's always here. I'll talk to Pastor Steve later. I see him. But people distant, they receiving it as if, man, this is my last morsel. You know, I'm going to put this into practice. He preached too strong for you to just come play around. So those who didn't really want it, they just click off. Leave their little nasty comment and go on, which is fine. Go on. This ain't for you. This is a catered meal. You know, this is for those who like that. You know, because we had went out to eat, and Sasha, because plantains, they have plantains. And I was like, oh, I don't like plantains. But Sisha, of course, she's in, because she'll eat them, and Hannah eat them. And Sasha's like, oh, I just cooked me some. She said it's an acquired taste. It is, you know, because if you didn't grow up on it, you're not, you know, it's an acquired taste. But I tried to make myself eat it, and I was like, I don't like it. Okay, let me see where I am. Okay. Oh, was I still reading, y'all? I am? Okay, where did I stop at? Okay, Jesus answered. I told you all I would get off in a heartbeat and forget where I was. Jesus answered and said it to him. If a man loved me, he would keep my words, and my father would love him and would give, and he would come unto him and make our abode with him. He that loveth me not keepeth not my sayings. This is how I know if you a lover of Christ or not. Amen. Jesus said it, and it's in red. Amen. He said, if they don't love my father, my words ain't in them. So, why would I sit there and argue with someone who ain't a lover of his word? Light and darkness cannot mix. We have nothing in common. So why would I can't change what you believe. You can't change what I believe. We're just going to cause each other frustration. Yes. So I will move on. You can stay there and argue with yourself, but I'll move on. I mean, I don't understand why people don't get that. Just move on. We don't agree. I don't hate you because we don't agree. If you needed my assistance, something happened to you, I'm not going to not help you. I'm going to still help you. am compelled to help you. Amen.
Amen.
He that loveth me not keepeth not my sayings, and the word which ye hear is not mine, but the Father's which sent me. These things have I spoken unto you, being yet present with you. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name. He, this Comforter ain't no magic trick. It ain't the devil, you know. The Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, with whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I had said unto you. Amen. And that's how I know. That's why I was dealing with these videos that they putting up. The Comforter will teach me all things and bring all things to my remembrance. I know what order looks like. I know what the voice of God sounds like. I ain't gotta watch y'all videos, but in my spirit, like, this is how God gonna speak to you about something. No, just say that we watched that anointed service. We didn't know Pastor Steve had more bullets in the chamber with his family. Just say that instead of saying, well, God showed me Steve and Joe gonna take it. It's obvious. You can see it. Y'all thought I was just sitting up being cute. I was sitting up because I was watching over my husband. If anybody came through this door, I'd be the first. Well, Grant, you know, Grant might not want me to say that because Grant be like, man, I got Pastor Dorby. But I can see the monitor that leads to outside from up here. I can see it clear, you know. But I was sitting there for a reason. He wanted me there for a reason because I can see. I just know how to dress. So that's why I look cute. But I can see. Amen. But he well prepared us. Amen. Go have the nurse say, God showed me y'all. Man, we ain't have to do nothing. See, Joe and DeJuan put them out. Amen. Which was supposed to happen. You're just in disorder. You don't come in here setting order in this home. It's already set. You ain't gonna tell us who we are. We know. We just didn't know. That's the ministry is still a viable ministry. You didn't know. Amen. Amen. I'm trying to take credit. The nerve of people. I'm trying to take credit for some order that they didn't even set. Why? Y'all just didn't know. He didn't have to because he was up here. We didn't have to shine. We still don't have to shine. We're just doing what he told us to do. Amen. Amen. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Ye have heard how I said unto you, I go away and come again unto you. If ye love me, ye would rejoice, because I said I go unto the Father, and my Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it come to pass, that when it has come to pass, you may believe. Hereafter, I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world cometh and hath nothing in me. But that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me commandment, even so I do. Arise, let's go henceforth. Amen?
Amen.
The Holy Spirit is God's Spirit dwelling in us. He is gentle. The Holy Spirit ain't gonna cuss you out. Bitter water and sweet water can never mix. It can't come out of the same fountain. So if you just got through cussing somebody out, giving them a piece of your, and you really literally gave them a piece of your mind, every time you do that, you scattering yourself, amen? The Holy Spirit convicts us of sin, which is to show us where we are wrong. He is a convictor of sin. Amen? The devil condemns. And when you're feeling condemned, it makes you feel like you will never be forgiven. And in turn, you will run from God. So know the difference between condemnation and being condemned. Amen? Yes, if you're doing something wrong and God is convicting you in your heart, your spirit man, I say, you know you shouldn't have said that.
Right.
Repent of it. But if you hear the condemnation, see, you ain't good. God don't love you. You ain't nothing. If the people at church find out, they ain't gonna never forgive you. No, ain't nobody perfect. We know you. I mean, Jesus was the only perfect one. There are times you are going to miss it, and you don't even be trying to miss it. But it could be a testing for you to humble yourself to get you right, you know? And so, when you're feeling convicted, repent. If you heard that word about the fornication, repent. Just get right, God, I'll repent. I was wrong. God, I shouldn't have cussed them out. I'm sorry. And guess what God's going to have you do? Go to that person. That's why I'll be like, oh, Lord, let me watch my mouth. Let me. Not that I cuss. I don't cuss y'all. Because that man in the line, he got so mad that he was saying a cuss word. I'm like, I don't care about you cussing, but you're still wrong. He was so, because he was, he was so wrong. And instead of saying, I apologize. You weren't wrong. I shouldn't have said nothing to you. I don't even know you. But gonna try to rebuke me. I don't think rebuke ain't even a good word. Gonna try to put me in my place. Cause he said and he's right. And he was totally wrong. And so, you know, when they get red, and I don't know if he was red or not. But he was wrong. Instead of saying, I'm sorry, I'm wrong, he gonna try to still be right in his error. Like, but you were wrong. Okay, we receive spiritual power after being infilled. This is the power that causes you to truly live right. That when you are beginning to be tested, like just say for instance, Pastor, you always say it, you still got the Negro's number or whatever. He called you. The Holy Spirit power will be like, you can't witness to him. Y'all got too much. A soul tie that you ain't even broke yet. Bye. I don't even want to say hi, how you doing? Bye. Don't call her no more. And that's, you know, the Holy Spirit will give you the power, like, nope, to resist him, to, you know, to even when you're feeling like, I'm about to cuss him out. The Holy Spirit will be like, watch your words. Your words. Have a good day. You know what? Thank you. And they'll leave them baffled, like, amen. But the Holy Spirit will give you the infilling, because you will be, when, before you feel, you will begin to bubble up on the hearing. It ain't no mind thing. When you pray, you pray with the mind. You're praying with your natural words. And as you begin to enter into worship, you're forgetting about the natural, trying to find words to say. It just becomes a flow of dormant to the Father. God, you're so worthy. You're so awesome. I adore you. I worship you. And then from there, you begin to weep in his presence. And you're like, oh, I worship God. You're awesome. And then when he has his way, when he sees that this vessel, this temple is ready for him, because he said he won't dwell in no unclean vessel. When he sees that this vessel is ready, also bubbling up, comes on out, and whatever the words are. And you continue to pray in those words, because he's communicating, he's downloading. It's like, God, I bless you, you know. And that's the infilling of the Holy Spirit, amen? I'll read Romans 8 and 26, 8, 26 and 27. You get to say amen. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. And there are times you don't know how you should pray. That's when you begin to pray. If your Holy Spirit filled, you begin to pray in the Holy Ghost. Amen. But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings, which words cannot be uttered. Amen. And if you are a real worshiper, a prayer warrior, an intercessor, Now it becomes a point where the words, you can't even speak words no more. And the tongues begin to change and you're just crying out. You're travailing before the Lord. You ain't thinking about who sees you. Most of the stuff you're doing in your personal prayer time anyway. You're just crying out before the Lord. You're humbling yourself, you know, and he's just having his way. It's all for his glory. And you still may not know the answer to the situation. You may be praying over that messed up marriage. Don't give up. Man, put prayer on it. Man, get some anointing oil. Don't tell him nothing. I'm anointing still. When I talk to him, I'm like, girl, look, anoint that pillow. Anoint that shoe. Don't tell him. Be wise. I'm going to anoint this man's shoes. Man, Lord, and it's going to take some breaking on your behalf, because the one who's more spiritually accountable is going to be the one who God's hold accountable to set the reign, the order in that home until, if it's the man, until he gets saved. Amen. So you're going to have to be the one that does the praying. You know, a lot of people are like, but it ain't fair. No, it ain't fair. Who said life is fair? Who said that being a Christian is fair? Who said that life just period is fair? Ain't nothing fair. But we do it. We become obedient Christians. We do it. Amen. So you anoint, even if it's your wife, anoint her, anoint some stuff. And you keep praying. You keep fasting and you keep praying. Amen. So Romans 28 and 26. Amen. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. So if you're praying and you like, God, I want this man to marry me. I want him to. You can say what you want to say. God ain't moving. You can't witchcraft God to make this man marry you. You can't use your anointing oil to make this man. God ain't moved off of error, off of your witchcraft ways. That ain't no word, because that's not his word. You pray, he knows what's the mind of Christ. Like, if it's really God, then that man that decides if he want to marry you. But you can't tell this man, you better marry me, unless you get him up in your bed. And you're like, well, dude, look, you can't live a life. We can't live like this, you know. Amen. But you can't see somebody and be like, oh, I'm going to put some prayer on that. That's my husband. No, it ain't. But, y'all, this happens. And that's why I will always be like, I was always straight and let these women know, no, baby, I will check you. Because they will come. They have for a pastor first. And then they come into a ministry like this. They look around like, men? Ooh, so when whores will come in, we'll be on whore defense. If she don't want Christ, like, honey, Mary changed when she met Christ. Like, if you don't want Christ, then you only come in here for one other reason, to try to take somebody's husband. Because now it's acceptable to be a side chick. You ain't gonna be one up in her. And we ain't gonna have no side chick, nothing, not up in her. I'll be like, man, it don't be fair, because this is a whore. She don't want Jesus. And if the whoremonger comes in, the men are already, we ain't gotta say nothing. The pastor used to look at the men, whoremonger, you know, and the men will be like, going to be on that man. Like, you ain't taking no lamb out of her. You ain't no eating on up to a lamb. The man will already be there. Now, are you trying to court this sister? If so, then she needs to start asking you some stuff or Pastor Steve taught on. Your duck, what's it? Your R's? Your W's? Your W's. You know, because we believe in court. And we ain't trying to stop nobody from getting married. But if you're a whoremonger, then you're a whore. Watch him. Amen. 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 Oh, and then let's go to Psalms 51. Psalms 51. I was going to read all of this, but it's pretty long. Amen. I'm going to find what I was. It's talking about David. He's talking about when he sinned and God seen it. He's just crying out his heart to God, asking him to have mercy on him. And when I saw this in the Word as I was growing. I was like, I was going through things that I didn't even know that other people were dealing with in the Bible.
Amen.
Because, like I said, God had to, He had to crush me, and my spirit was broken. I was broken, and I just was crying out to God. I didn't know other people went through stuff. I didn't know that, you know, because I thought they came to God with a willing heart. Well, I didn't. I was trying to do my will. And I'm trying to find the verse where it says, a broken spirit. Yes, that's what it's in here. 17. Seeing that thou hate instruction and correction. Seeing that thou hate instruction and correction and cast my words behind, you discard. Oh, hold on. 17. 51. 50. Oh, I'm in 50. I'm sorry. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. Oh God, thou would not despise. Amen.
Amen?
Contrite means caused by a showing sincere remorse.
Amen.
Filled with a sense of guilt. The second meaning of it is filled with a sense of guilt and the desire for atonement, penance.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
And when I saw this, I was like, what? David had a broken spirit and a contrite heart. You know, these things, the word begins to make sense to me because I'm going through these same things. You know, after months of me repenting and purging, I received the infilling. Well, I had already told you. I received the infilling of the Holy Spirit. I cherish having God's spirit in me,
Amen.
Leading me into all truth.
Amen.
If you're wanting to develop a personal relationship with God, start setting the atmosphere in your home,
Amen.
Your car,
Amen.
With worship music.
Amen.
Be respectful about the volume when it comes to your job.
Yes.
This is where a lot of Christians go wrong at. A lot of times when they get saved, instead of them using wisdom, they begin to see, especially if it's a husband and wife, we see this a lot, where the wife may get saved and she want to go home because the husband won't convert fast enough for her. Well, she want to go home and pray out loud, knowing that, okay, respect this man. He ain't a Christian. You trying to win him. You ain't trying to push him away. If he's wanting to watching TV and she feel like he should be watching the TV, I'm trying to pray, go in your room and pray. But instead of her just praying in the room, she won't cut the music up all loud. Well, you're going to be pushing this person that you're trying to win to Christ away because you're being disrespectful. What you want to do is have a gentle and quiet spirit, be kind to the person, and then they will see your lifestyle and want to change. But if you think you're going to keep cutting this music up, if you think you're going to keep telling them off and then go pray, they ain't going to see you as no Christian. They ain't going to want your God. They're going to see you as a hypocrite. Amen? And that happens all the time. People don't understand why they can't win their family members. Maybe they see you as a hypocrite by the way your actions, your words, how you live your life. You look holy one minute, but when you get over here at home, you won't cuss them out. You want to tear the father off. You know, you want to, you know, just speak negative words over your loved ones, but you want them to receive your Christ. Well, your Christ looks like a sick Christ to them. So you have to be mindful with how you represent Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen. So you're setting the atmosphere of worship in your home. You're watching what you watch on TV. Amen. You're watching your eyes. Our eyes can't be seeing everything.
Amen.
You know, we can't watch every movie that comes out.
Amen.
You know, it ain't, we're children of the, children of the world. Oh, Lord, we're not children of the world no more. We're children of the light. Light and dark. We don't do things at night. We even set that in our home and we tell people here, we're children of the light. Do your stuff in the light.
Amen.
We don't run the streets at night.
Amen.
And we don't do that. We have a standard. We don't want our good to be evil spoken of. It doesn't matter what age you are.
Amen.
Your good can still be evil spoken of.
Amen.
Just by being somewhere you shouldn't be, being at the time you was there.
Right.
You know.
Amen.
So we're children of the light. Amen.
Amen.
And we watch what we watch. We don't, just because it's a hit movie, well, we don't deal with hits. We're Christians. We got the hit. We ain't on that hit. We don't move and operate like the world does. So that's why what the world do, I concur less.
Amen.
What they see is good, how they feel, how they think you should be. I'm not moved by y'all. Y'all are not my standard. God is my standard. I get my download for His word is the standard for our life. This is how we govern ourselves. Amen. So I'm not looking to be accepted by everybody. I know you're not going to accept me because I'm not worldly. I can deal with you, interact with you, do business with you. But when it comes to my standard, I'm going to keep my standard. I'm not changing for you. It doesn't matter because they changed the laws and said, I'm still off of God's word. God's word. I'm going to treat you like a human being, but I believe what I believe. Amen. And you can believe what you mad at me because I won't change my belief to how you believe.
Amen.
So who's controlling?
Amen.
You know? Right. You know, who's controlling then?
Amen.
Are you tolerant of me?
Amen.
If tolerance got to work both ways.
Amen.
If you want me to tolerate, you sure got to tolerate what I say.
Amen.
And how I live. If you're talking about lifestyle, we can talk.
Right.
Hey, we can talk. But in the end, you're going to get mad at me. I ain't going to get mad at you.
Amen.
I'm going to tell you to do your thing. But leave me alone.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Okay. Start watching what your eyes watch on TV. Watch the words that come out of your mouth. Begin to introduce fasting into your relationship with God. Start at half a day. If you've never fasted before, you cannot be a Christian and walk in this life if you get any spiritual wake up understanding. Then you know too much. You become a target to the devil.
Amen.
You can't go back out there and try to live the way you used to live.
Amen.
And try to fit in. You're going to be a target to the devil. He's either going to start trying to take you out because you're playing, you straddling the fence.
Amen.
And then when you see people get taken out like that, people will never follow you. You will always be a hypocrite. They'll never see you as a Christian because you playing.
Amen.
You know? And that we've seen that happen once where a man all his life, he kept straddling. He was supposed to be called being a pastor or whatever, but he wouldn't leave the women alone. He kept messing with the women. So everybody knew him as, you didn't see him as a man of God. Because you know, he's always messing with the women. He's always messing out messing around on his wife. And when his opportunity finally came to pastor again, because he kept trying to have a church, but it wouldn't work because of his adultery. He wouldn't be faithful to God in that area. And his wife eventually divorced him because she got tired. And he tried to get remarried, and that didn't work. But when his opportunity finally came to lead a church, his years of dirty life, nobody will follow. You know. And so, you know, and that's a sad thing, because if he probably was called but wouldn't get the flesh under control. Amen. That's your job. To get this flesh under control by prayer and fasting.
Amen.
So introducing fasting to your relationship.
Amen.
You have to fast. You have to deny this body.
Yes.
You have to learn to deny. You can't let this body tell you, oh, I'm hungry, eat.
Amen.
No, you tell this body, shut up.
Amen.
You rebuke the headache.
Amen.
You rebuke any sickness you're dealing with, you can rebuke.
Amen.
Even when it comes to Pastor Doyle, because our internet audience didn't know, because we haven't been live streaming on Wednesdays. That's because we've been having family time here at Destin Ministries talking.
Amen.
Well, we stood in faith. Yes. And then the people online, they say, like, well, I believe too.
Amen.
Why we believe? Because His Word says it. His Word says it. Being resurrected ain't nothing new.
Amen.
And we was believing. I know God probably like, dude, they hold you back. And I know He's like, Father, I'm straight. You know, like, it wasn't that we didn't have faith. It's past glory. He's up there in glory. You know, He probably like, I love them, but I love my wife, I love my kids, but I ain't trying to go back. They don't have to wait to see me, you know. But I still be like, when I go see my husband, it's like, God, this is a small thing for you to do. You rolled away the stone from Jesus' grave. You can make this dirt come up, get him up out of there, we go home. Amen. I still receive him back. Cough it all up. Get it out of there. Make the heart new, organs new. I still love it, man. Amen. Amen. But it's not that we didn't have faith. Our faith was great. It's strong. We operated like a modern day Acts church, y'all. Do you know how uncommon that is? Amen. That is so uncommon to see that. And I had to stop at the, my husband still had cleaners in the dry cleaners, and I'm not going to leave it there. I'm going to pick his stuff up, so I was picking it up, and this man was bringing his stuff in, and the woman was like, oh, I remember you, such and such, and I said, I know that name. I said, excuse me, are you sister such and such husband? He was like, yeah. I said, tell her. I said, hi. And he was like, sister. He said, man, they called me and told me about Pastor Dorf. We started believing. I mean, if you saw him, you're like, man, this man is asleep. In which is, that's what they'll be, asleep. So I'm like, baby, wake up. Let's go. Let me wake up. But anyways, he was saying, we're believing. And he was just saying that a pastor from Africa was at their church, and the woman that served under him had died. And he was like, God, she has been such a great help to me. I need her back. He was saying the morgues in Africa ain't like the morgues here in America. He was like, you had to go in the, that they put all the bodies together in the pit. He was like, he had to go. He said, the African pastor said, I had a group of pastors that we were all going, some of them backed out. He said, well, we went, and there was some more church members with. They weren't praying for that sister. He was like, she was such a great help to me. Well, they prayed her life back to her body. It's just a prayer. I mean, it's not hard to, we are Christians. This is what we believe. And they brought her back to life. Amen? Amen. Okay. And then, like, in the Bible, when, Doris, she sold for everybody. I know about sewing. She sold. She was passed on. She went to sleep, which we consider death. They went in and prayed for her. Everybody was like, no, she was a great woman. Just like we saw Pastor Steve, he was a great man, you know. But I know Pastor Steve was like, I'm at peace, I'm happy, it wasn't our faith. It was, he was in glory, he don't want to come back. And I respect that, but shoot, we want you back. We want you, we still want you back. Amen. I'm almost finished. If you're wanting to develop a personal relationship with God, start setting the atmosphere. Oh, I read that. Okay, and I was saying introducing fasting. You have to fast.
Amen.
Start somewhere.
Amen.
And commit to it.
Amen.
And then grow in your fasting. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. Yeah, if you know me, you know I love Vintage Fred.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen that episode of Seinfeld? When that music come on, the El Dorado song, and the guy's like, I'm like that when it comes to my Vintage Fred Hammond and Marvin Sapp. I love that's worship. And I done wrote down all of Fred Hammond's albums that you can listen to, because you can't find modern worship.
Yes.
I'm going to give Travis Green a shout out, because I like his stuff.
Amen.
You know when people's been praying because it's anointed music.
Amen.
But Vintage Fred, the inner court. You talk about some worship? Whoa. The inner court. You can pray off of that. You can leave it running in your home, in your car. You can leave it running down low like crock pot. Shoot. The purpose by design. Pages of life, chapters 1 and 2. The spirit of David. Shoot. Vintage Fred. Put that on. I'm going to be up in the spirit real fast. Amen. And of course, Marvin Sapp, vintage Marvin Sapp. This newer music, I don't really care about. Because it's like, who are you singing to? God ain't getting, like, you got these Corey bots. Look that word up if you don't know what it means. You know, you got these Corey bots. You know, they want to, like, you. This ain't no worship. This is the abomination that causes desolation standing in the holy place. This, you know, and then you got the whores, you know, it's like, no, honey, put on some clothes. And we'll still be talking about clothes here. Because I'm a woman, and I understand, like, honey, you know you can see your cleavage. You know you can, where's your slip at? I'm still, y'all still old school. I'm young, but I believe in wearing a slip. Get out of them body con dresses. Mm-mm. Save it for the bedroom if you're married. Well, put on some stuff. Be respect. You will get respected if you look respectable. I'm telling you. You will be respected if you look respectable. Amen? I mean, you ain't got to look like, I'm different. I have my own style. But develop you a style. But just stay away from everything that's revealing. Oh, and then when it comes to women, with this big pulling your breast out to breastfeed, that's natural. But cover yourself up. I will make you a nursing cover up. I will make you. I love making that. When these women here that's married, they have their babies, I make them a nursing cover up, a custom made. And people be like, ooh, where'd you get that from? And Sister Janika said, she said, I took my baby to the doctor, and, you know, and she was nursing her baby. She had a cover up. And the woman was like, where'd you get that from? She's like, my first lady made it. Put that Jamaican accent on her. And then it's like, what? Because it had her name on her. And then she poured out the little, the diaper wipe cloths to have the baby's name on it. Yes, custom made stuff. Amen. Amen. So that was the ending of my message. I hope you all got something out of it.